In the previous video, we used Ampere's law to calculate the magnetic field generated by a thick cylindrical shell conductor carrying a current of I. Now in this video, we're going to throw in a new complication. The current density in the conductor is no longer uniform. In fact, it's dropping off like 1 over r, where r is the distance to the symmetry axis of the conductor. So we can see in the instructions here at the top that the current density, which we normally call J, is given by K divided by R, where K is a constant. And we're asked to find the magnetic field magnitude in all three regions. In other words, inside the inner radius A, outside the outer radius B, and then in between A and B, in other words, within the conductive material itself. Finally, each of these magnetic fields needs to be expressed in terms of the total current I in the wire, rather than the constant K. At the bottom, we're given a couple quick reminders. There's Ampere's law, stating that the path integral around an Amperian loop is equal to mu naught times the current enclosed by that loop. And I've also shown an Amperian loop in the diagrams, and that Amperian loop has a radius that we'll call little r. And the particular loop that's shown on this slide is for the case where r is between A and B. And I'll post a link to my derivation of Ampere's law if you need a refresher on this stuff. We also get a quick reminder of the basic definition of current density. And that's current per unit cross-sectional area, which I just wrote here as I divided by A, where A is the conducting cross-section that the current is spread over. Now it looks simple to turn this around to calculate a current based on a known current density. So we could just write I equals J times A. But with a non-uniform current density, that means J takes a different value at every value of R. So it's not going to be as simple as I equals J times A. We'll have to look at this in differential form, and we'll get to that modification when we need it later in the problem. So the first things we're going to knock out are the two trivial cases for the magnetic field, and that's outside the radius B and inside the radius A. So we'll start with an Amperian loop outside the outer radius of the thick shell conductor, in other words, when R is greater than B. And just a quick reminder here, we expect the magnetic field to swirl concentrically around the symmetry axis of the conductor according to the usual right-hand rule. So in the face-on diagram on the right, where the current is coming out of the page right at us, the magnetic field should be swirling counterclockwise, and it'll be aligned with the path increments as we integrate along the Amperian loop in that counterclockwise direction. So we write down Ampere's law. And the right side of Ampere's law is trivial here because the enclosed current is just the total current I in this case. Now the left-hand side is nice because the path integral is trivial as well. With B aligned with the path increments dl, the dot product is trivial and reduces to the product of magnitudes of B times dl. In addition, by symmetry, B must be constant along this path. In other words, the magnetic field has a constant magnitude as long as we're at a fixed radius from the symmetry axis. So that B can be factored out of the integral. And now all we're left with our path integral is the integral of dl itself around the closed loop, which is the circumference of that loop. So that's just 2 pi r. So now we can just solve for B by dividing by 2 pi r on both sides, and we've got our magnetic field. And this is a familiar result. We get this classic result, mu naught I over 2 pi r, which is the same thing we found for the magnetic field outside of thin and thick wires in several previous examples. Okay, so let's check out the r less than A case. In other words, inside the hollow part of this thick conductive shell. So we start again by writing down Ampere's law. And we expect the magnetic field, if there is any magnetic field in there, to have all the same symmetries as before. And that means the left-hand side of Ampere's law reduces to the same B times 2 pi r for all the same reasons. But this time, the enclosed current is zero. We're not enclosing any conductive material at all. There can't be any current inside that Amperian loop. So I enclosed is zero over there on the right-hand side. Well, of course, the entire right-hand side vanishes now. And we can divide by 2 pi r to solve for B. And we find out that B is equal to zero. So now that we've knocked out the two trivial cases for this problem, we can get to the real point of this video, and that's finding the magnetic field within the conductive material itself, where the enclosed current is going to depend on the size of the Amperian loop. So again, we start by writing down Ampere's law. And as usual, the path integral on the left-hand side is trivial, and that reduces to B times 2 pi r. And the complication this time is that the enclosed current within this loop requires its own calculation because that's only part of the total current I flowing in the conductor. So our challenge lies with this term on the right-hand side of Ampere's law how do we calculate I enclosed? Well, we can't get this value by simply multiplying the current density times the enclosed conducting cross-sectional area. In other words, it's not as simple as J times A, because the value of J is changing with radius. So here's where we have to use a calculus idea. If we split the enclosed area into thin rings, then the value of J is constant within the infinitesimal width of each ring. And now we can multiply J times the area contained in that ring wall to get an enclosed current contribution for each ring. So we're going to call the radius of each thin ring R prime, just to distinguish it from little r, the radius of the Amperian loop. And then the thickness of each ring, we're going to call that dr prime. Now to find the enclosed current contribution within the ring wall, we're going to write the differential form of our formula for enclosed current. So a small current contribution contained in this thin ring wall, we're going to call that di enclosed, and that's J times dA, where dA is the area of the ring wall. This is now a well-defined expression because J has a unique value at that single radius R prime. So in the next step, we sub in our formula for the variable current density. We're going to write that as K over R prime, and we replace dA with its expression in terms of R prime as well. So there it is, we've replaced J with K divided by R prime. That's its unique value at a radius of R prime from the center. And then we have the area contained in that thin ring wall. And that area dA is found by cutting and unrolling the ring, which then becomes a rectangle of length 2 pi r, in other words, the original circumference, then multiplied by the thickness dr prime. So it looks like we're in luck here because our r primes are going to cancel out and we'll get a really simple expression for di enclosed. So that's simply going to be 2 pi k times dr prime. Remember, k is a constant here, so this is a very simple expression. And now that we have an expression for di enclosed, we're ready to add up all the current contributions inside this Amperian loop by using an integral. So there's our expression for di enclosed. And I just want to take a second to make this point that to find the total enclosed current, all we're doing is adding up all the infinitesimal contributions. And this is exactly what an integral is. So this is a summation device for adding up infinitely many infinitesimal contributions. So we're going to say the total enclosed current is the sum of all the contributions. Now I can replace di enclosed with its expression in terms of r prime, and that's simply 2 pi k times dr prime. And then we're adding up all of these current contributions all the way from the smallest value of r, which is a, out to the edge of the Amperian loop, which is little r. So we're integrating from a to little r. So everything in that integrand is a constant, except for the dr prime. When we integrate that, we just get an r prime out of that. And we're evaluating from a to little r. So now we just sub in the upper and lower limits, and we have an expression for the total enclosed current in this Amperian loop. So that turns out to be 2 pi k times little r minus little a. All right, so that's progress, because now we can sub in for I enclosed in Ampere's law. So as I do this, I'm going to go ahead and divide by 2 pi r on both sides so we can solve for b. So on the right-hand side of Ampere's law, we had a mu naught I enclosed, which is now mu naught times 2 pi k times the quantity r minus a. And then to isolate b, we divided both sides by 2 pi little r. And these two pi's are going to cancel out. And we end up with an expression for the magnetic field inside this conductive material as mu naught k times the quantity r minus a, all divided by r. So that's great, but we're not done yet, because remember, we want to express the magnetic field in all these different regions in terms of the total current carried by this thick conducting shell. That means we need to relate that little k to the total current I. And to get this done, we just basically do the same kind of integral we just did for I enclosed, but we're going to go all the way from A to B and add up all the current in the entire wire, giving us a grand total of capital I. So I'm going to write down that the total current is going to be the integral of all the di contributions over rings that go all the way from A to B. So I end up with an integral from A to B. Remember, the current contained within a single ring is given by 2 pi k dr prime. And we're going to add those up as r prime goes from A to B, giving us that grand total, which we call capital I. So the integral turns out to be the same. It's just an r prime that pops out of that, and we evaluate it from A to B. So I'm just going to go ahead and jump straight to the final answer here. It's 2 pi k times the quantity B minus A. And this is our connection between k and the total current I. I can just solve this for k. So k is going to be the total current I divided by 2 pi times the quantity B minus A. And now we can sub that into our expression for the magnetic field and get our final answer. So looking at this expression that we got in terms of K, I'm just going to replace the K with an I divided by 2 pi times quantity B minus A. And this gives me a mu naught I, not a surprising term to see in our answer, times R minus A, all divided by 2 pi R. Remember, there was a factor of little r down there in the expression for B, times the quantity B minus A. Now we can do a couple crude checks on our work here just to make sure at the boundaries where we're switching between these different regions of magnetic field, this expression for inside the conducting material itself agrees with what happens on the inner boundary and the outer boundary. So we can look at R equals A as an example. So on the boundary of that inner hollow space where we know the magnetic field has to be zero. Well, if you sub in R equals A into this expression, that term in the numerator, R minus A, becomes zero, and I end up with a magnetic field of zero, which agrees with our previous result for the interior of the cavity. If I do a similar thing for R equals B, replacing R with B means you have a factor of B minus A in the top and bottom of this rational expression, and those are going to cancel out, and I end up with this classic result, mu naught I over 2 pi R. So that agrees with the calculation we did for R greater than B. This video is part of a series on Ampere's law and its applications, and you can find a link to that playlist on the lower left of the end screen. In the next video, we derive a formula for the magnetic field within a long solenoid or coil of wire by using Ampere's law. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left when it's done, and I'll see you there.